What we need to do in architecture as architects and professionals is we need to give up our clinging to the righteousness of poverty. Hello, Architect Nation. This is Enoch Sears, and this is the show where you'll discover tips, strategies, and secrets for setting up your practice so that you can do your best work more often. Because here at Business of Architecture, we believe and we're convinced that you don't need to sacrifice your health, your financial wealth, your sense of fulfillment, or your mental sanity, or your relationships to do work that you love. To find out more about Business of Architecture's Smart Practice Program, our guided program where we work with you individually on a firm-by-firm basis to structure your firm for more fun, more freedom, and more profit, go to smartpracticemethod.com. Today, I continue my conversation with Rion Willard, who's the Director of Consulting here at Business of Architecture, as well as the host of the BOA UK, Business of Architecture UK podcast. We continue our conversation around this insidious mind virus that has taken over the architecture industry, the cult of design. So without further ado, here is today's episode. This is part three. You can go back to our two previous episodes to hear part one and part two. So let's have a little thought experiment here. Let's say there's someone's going to build $1 million house. How could we charge a $10 million fee for that house?
What do you mean? Like by providing $10 million worth of value?
Yeah. How could we provide $10 million worth of value if the house is only worth $1 million?
Through marketing and sales?
Ah, I think so.
Through finding the pain or understanding where does the value lie in from the client's perspective?
Absolutely. Like, let's take an example. So I'm holding a pen right here. Okay, this pen. Pretend for those who are listening on the podcast, pretend like I have a pencil. Okay, and I tell you this pencil, you can go down to the store and you can buy it for $1.50. Right now, let's just say on the other hand that this was Al Capone's pencil. Okay, Al Capone was a famous gangster in the United States. He's quite infamous over here. I don't know if people are around the world would know who Al Capone is, right? Or some other famous celebrity, right? Jesus Christ. It was Jesus Christ's pencil. You know, Jesus Christ wrote the Sermon on the Mount with this very pencil. You know, suddenly it goes from something that's commoditized, $1.50, to something that literally has no value. Because it's going to be worth what people pay for it. So here's the principle at play. Architecture is worth what people will pay for it, yes, but you're the one that has the power to create that desire to a certain degree, right? So, you know, if we say, now, again, I'm putting a very absurd example here, $1 million home and $10 million fee, just to kind of break our minds out and say, okay, wait a second, it's not as linear as I thought it was, right? I tend to think that my fees are limited to 10 to 15 to 20% of the construction costs, which for most of you, they probably are. Right? But there's a big difference between 10% and 20%, right? And there's a lot of firms out there that I know that are charging 20. There are firms I know that are charged 20% simply for the architecturals, while other firms are struggling to pay to charge 5%. What's the difference there? It's branding, it's connections, it's their ability, as we said, to market and sell. Although architects would probably never actually, we don't use those terms in the industry because they're a bit distasteful, right? But if I was, you know, if this was like the very last Frank Lloyd Wright home or something, it may be worth $10 million, even though it cost $1 million to construct, right? So celebrity is one thing that can allow you, people will pay more for someone who's a celebrity, okay? So, who are the celebrity architects? Like, we know people like Frank Gehry. Frank Gehry right now can write his own ticket in terms of fees. The fees he charges are exorbitant. Now, I bring up this example, not to say we all need to be like Frank Gehry, but just to show, again, that fees aren't as linear as we think they are. This is the key here. Fees are not as linear as you think they are. You think your fees are limited by what other people are charging. You think your fees are limited by how clients perceive your value. The beautiful part is that you have the ability to influence how your value is perceived. And so as this great Stoic philosopher said, focus on what you can control and forget the rest. Okay. So sure, we may not be able to influence and impact the greater conversation around the economy and the rise and fall of nations. But what we can do is within our own world, we can become very good. We can acquire the skills of marketing, selling, presenting our services, building our value, charging very, very high fees for the value that we provide. Because in my estimation, architects provide, just let's take residential architects for an example. They provide enormous value to homeowners or people that are going to be living in a home. You know, what's the value to someone above and beyond the real estate value? Because that's what we typically look at is like, okay, how much will this house be worth when I sell it? You know, we're ignoring the value of someone's well-being within that home. Like for instance, Rion, in my house, you haven't been to my home, but when you come over to the US, you'll come visit it. And we have a beautiful mid-century modern home. I love our home. It has glass all around the backside of it that looks out on our pool, and we have a little spa and a fountain back there. It's gorgeous. However, I believe it was built by a tract builder. I don't know who designed the plan or whatever, but there's a flaw in the plan in that when I'm in my shower. So if I'm in my shower and my shower door's open in my master bedroom, when I'm in my shower, the mirror is situated such that I can see the entry foyer of my home.
So you're flashing people in the streets.
Literally, if my front door was open, if my front door was open and my bedroom door was open and my bathroom door was open, I could literally, and my shower door was open, that'd be quite rare, but I could be standing. For all of you who are listening, you get the picture of I could be standing there totally in my birthday suit, in my royal glory, and someone passing along the road could see me. Now, this may seem like a small little thing, right? But as an architect, you know, if you're listening to this, you're probably chuckling because you know this is the value that clients generally don't see. They don't understand that it's Go ahead, Ryan.
Is this a deliberate design feature, or this is a design faux pas?
I'm guessing it was not deliberate. Yeah, I'm thinking, right? So what ends up happening is it's extremely annoying because, I mean, I'm the kind of guy where I just like to leave my bathroom door open. I don't like to have it closed all the time, but now I have to have it closed because my bedroom door is open and my kids walk past, I mean, my daughter, she's going to be scarred for life. You know what I'm saying? She's going to have nightmares. You know, they're arresting me. They're throwing me in jail or something, you know? So what's the point of that? The point is that it's design, as you know, as an architect, and I'm speaking to our audience here, you know, as an architect, that it's not just about the money. Like there's something deep inside of you, like you know this conversation, we're preaching to the choir here, right? You know that it's not just about the real estate value. But what's frustrating, and I know it's frustrating for you, is like, how do you then communicate the value of that? Because I'll tell you, every time I go into my bathroom, not every time, but a lot of times, it's like a continual frustration for me. And what's the impact of that frustration, as small as it is, on my mental well-being, when I relate to my wife, when I relate to my kids, in my job? We may think these little tiny things don't add up and don't have an impact, but I'd have you consider that they actually, what if they do? Like really, what if they do? And then that brings us back to the conversation of architecture. There was a study that was done that showed that people who are in an environment that is inspiring to them, they actually treat each other more nice. They treat each other nicer, more nicely. They treat each other nicely. They're more cordial to each other. They're kinder. So there's what we're suggesting here is that there's some inherent value in architecture beyond the financial aspect of it, right? So you know this as an architect, but what happens is now as architects, because we find ourselves impotent, as Rion so eloquently put it, we can't get it up, so to speak. In a financial sense, that we have to fall back on what we do well, which is design, right? And so then we fall back into the moral superiority or the self-righteousness of, well, you just won't get it. I'm a designer. I'm going to focus on design. We're saving the world, although we don't have the agency, as you so well put it in your manifesto, to be able to have an impact that we could have. Rion, you mentioned another myth that we find frequently is a portfolio is everything. Now, what's really interesting about this is if I had a dollar for every time I heard an architect tell me I can't get better projects because of my portfolio, I would be a very rich man. So this brings up an idea that, and this goes back to the cult of design as well, are the projects that you get limited by your portfolio? What do you think, Ryan?
Absolutely not.
And why not?
I think, I mean, when we look at it from a top-down scenario, and we look at all the rigor through which contemporary procurement process forces architects through, and the risk-averse nature of many clients, and particularly as clients become more sophisticated, they want to see more and more experience, and this becomes it becomes on one level seemingly more impenetrable, and we've got to have had the experience to be able to do it. We've got to have the portfolio. I don't have the portfolio. I haven't got pictures of the buildings. There's nothing there. And then we see these architects who are thinking about their value in a different way. Okay, so they're not just thinking about their value, they're thinking about what is valuable to the client and really getting under the skin of the conversation. So on the one sense, I'd make a distinction as well here about kind of cultural value and economic value. And the, you know, that there's the value of design, which we were just discussing, the kind of, you know, the lifestyle that it can enhance, and the well-being, and all this kind of nuanced stuff, which is kind of difficult for a client to imagine sometimes, unless you've helped them go there in their imaginations prior to that, or you've listened to them in a kind of active listening type of way and discovered what the emotional drivers are behind why they wanted to build this new house in the first place. What were some of the pains? If you're dealing with a commercial client, we've seen architects, like with developers, be able to listen to those clients, hear that actually what would be really valuable to a developer is how the fees are structured in an architectural service, or how the flow of money is being timed, because they're waiting on investment money or they're waiting on institutional finance. So for an architect to be creative with the way that they structure their own payment or finance, we've seen this in many circumstances be a way of circumventing the fact that they haven't done that kind of architecture project before in the past.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And I think that's really interesting, because this is going deep into, one, there's communicating the value of architecture, and then there's two, understanding what is valuable to the client in the first place.
Mm-hmm.
And then aligning what the value of architecture is with the value of what the client is looking to do. And that's often the missing piece of the conversation. And actually, certainly with commercial clients, they're a business entity and they're looking at being able to enhance their revenue. There's projects, there's fears, there's emotions involved, and getting creative, and again, salesmanship is the key thing here, being able to negotiate well and structure something which is prodding at the kind of emotional drivers of the other party, then this is where fees begin to get raised. I'll give you an example of this. We've got a client at the moment who is working with developers, and they have structured a deal where they're getting a bonus on every unit that gets planning approval. And by structuring it that way, they've got a base level of fee going in. Okay, so their kind of basic costs are covered. And then for every unit they get planning approval, they get this bonus. And if they get all of the units planning approval, which they're pretty confident they're going to be able to do, they're getting a fee which is, you know, in the order of 2.5 times more than what they would normally be able to ask for.
Yeah, and the question is, why would developers agree to that?
Because it's risk.
Yeah.
Because you're now taking on the risk. Yeah. In order for you to be able to take on the risk, okay, because the client values your ability to negotiate, understand, and take on and share the risk. Fantastic. Okay, and you're putting the value of architecture and design in there with the risk.
Yep.
Because you value it.
Beautiful.
So I think that's very interesting, and we see more and more of this kind of creative negotiations and collaborations with commercial partners. And again, you need to have a base level of financial hygiene and business health in order to be able to take those kinds of risks.
Rion, what we need to do in architecture as architects and professionals is we need to give up our clinging to the righteousness of poverty.
Now, where does the righteousness of poverty come from? What is this?
Being abused as children, I'm sure. I don't know. We didn't have nurturing parents. I don't know. I mean, this opens up a wider conversation is the way that commercialism is portrayed in the media. You know, my mind goes back to one of my favorite shows that we always love to watch around Christmas time. It's a Wonderful Life. Do you guys watch that in the UK?
Has
Jimmy Stewart in it? Yeah, it's like a classic. Every December, it's an old movie. I think it was made in let me look it up. It's A Wonderful Life. It's Jimmy Stewart. Great, great, fantastic movie. Black and white. James Stewart. Wonderful Life. 1946, right? And in the movie, there's a character, and I just bring this up because it's a great example of how wealthy people are personified or portrayed in the media, right? In our cultural conditioning, basically. But there's this gentleman, I think his name is Mr. Potter, and he's like the wealthy banker that lives in this small town, okay? And what he's doing, he's basically using an economic collapse to seize all of the homes of all the working class people in this little town in which the movie takes place. And they just, in the movie, he's portrayed like the rich man is portrayed as this horrible, greedy, curmudgeonly man that is just hates life and is angry at everyone and just cares about money and he's all about the almighty dollar, right? And then there's the protagonist, the Jimmy Stewart's character, who is this, you know, guy that basically discovers that the value of relationships are what matter. And it's not about the money. And he becomes this benevolent person that actually gives some of his own personal funds to kind of save the people's homes and risks his own personal bank to let the townspeople keep their properties, et cetera, right? And he starts up a loan fund to let people with limited income be able to start their own businesses. So we can see this time and time again in the media that you ask, where does it come from? I don't know. But what I do know is that when we look at the way that wealth is portrayed in the media, oftentimes there's a focus on exploitation. There's a focus on how the wealthy people have exploited, how they have robbed, they have destroyed the environment, right? We see corporations all the time that justifiably have done this, have, you know, not been good environmental stewards, polluted the environment for the sake of money. So I have a suspicion that part of it comes from that. Part of it comes from the negative stigma that, you know, as human beings, we can make sacrifices in the name of making more money, right? We can prioritize money over relationships. But is this always the hard and fast rule? And is this the narrative that we should cling to as architectural professionals? You know, I have a good friend of mine that lives in a housing development where the least expensive home is $10 million, the most expensive home is $100 million. It's right on the beachfront in Southern California. And I mean, $100 million for a home, that's a lot. But he said what's interesting is like people generally think that the uber wealthy, the extremely rich people are just not nice people. You know, we think of like these people on these reality TV shows who are corrupt, who are they're miserable, you know. The way they've gotten to the top is that they've gotten there through pure competition. They've cut throats. They've stabbed people in the back, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And he said, actually, you know, I know these people, and you know, a lot of them are very, they're giving, people don't even know about the charitable contributions they're making. They've built wonderful companies. They're actually very wonderful people. And he said, yeah, there's some rotten apples as well. There's definitely some people that are just, they're just mean spirited and they're just out there to make money and slash and burn and cut throats and steal their way to the top. He's like, yeah, there's definitely those people as well, right? But when we look at the way that industry and capitalism and the flow of money has impacted our modern world, Amazon, the ability that I can go now and I can order something within 1 or 2 days, it reaches my doorstep. Costco, I can go and at a reasonable cost, I can provide for my family and get practically anything that I want to eat or anything I want to consume. Restaurants, franchises, all of this, right? Although as architects, we like to look at, we like to point the finger at globalization and all the negative side effects of these things, it's a very one-sided conversation. So where does it come out of? I don't know, Ryan. Is it possible that it comes out of a feeling of moral superiority that if we're not making money, if we eschew money, if we become the martyrs, that we actually feel better about ourselves?
I mean, it's interesting. There is, again, kind of going back to the cult of design and the romance of being impoverished and the kind of assumed nobility that comes with it, and therefore the evil that must exist with being wealthy. Well, and like you say, there's of course evidence of plenty of wealthy people who are scumbags, but there's also loads of poor people who are scumbags as well.
Absolutely. So Ryan, you may not know this about me, but when I was in college, I lived in my car. So I slept in my car for the last 3 years of school. That's 2 years. The last 2 years of school, I slept in my car. So I was literally homeless. I didn't have a home. I slept in my car. It was like on the down low. And that was upstate New York. It was Ithaca, New York. And then later, after I graduated from architecture school, I lived on a boat for several years. For 7 years, I lived on a boat. And one of the reasons why I did both of those things was because I was eschewing capitalism. Literally, it was my rebellion against having to get a mortgage and having to play the game of finances, because I thought, you know what, there's something wrong with the capitalist society, so the way I'm going to deal with it is I'm going to remove myself from it, try to anyways. And I do remember, absolutely, I looked down my nose on all the people that had nice cars, nice homes. You know, for me, I remember actually, Ryan, going to one of these carbon footprint calculators. And I was like, I'm going to see what's my carbon footprint, because I literally lived in a boat. I didn't use much electricity because we just had like this little stove that we used. Like my carbon footprint was like very minimal. The boat was built out of fiberglass, but it was built like back in the 1960s. So the embodied carbon in that was like long since had paid for itself.
Was this in, upstate New York?
This was down in Houston when I was living in Houston, which is Houston actually is very close to the water. And so we were down near Galveston, actually down Clear Lake, because there's Galveston Bay there. So it was in when I was in Houston in Texas. And lived in a boat for 7 years, right? And the reason, going back, the reason why I did that, because we're asking, okay, what is it about making money? What is it about materialism? What is it about our self-righteous poverty? I definitely had a self-righteous poverty about myself. And so my hallucination is that a lot of the practice owners who scrape by and justify scraping by, right? Justify not being able to pay their employees the highest salaries, justify undercutting other architects, is that there's something noble about it. There's something noble and highly moral about it. What do you think, Ryan? Do you think I'm completely off on that?
No, I think there's a nobility, an assumed nobility and romance about kind of being impoverished, and you know, we've got the romantic ideals, the romance of the starving artist. In the architecture industry, we've got these kind of titans of design. Louis Kahn springs to mind, you know, the very sad story of how his life ended and he was found dead in the toilet of, was it Penn Station?
I believe so.
In New York.
Yeah.
And he kind of died bankrupt and the business was, you know, just a wreck. And then the stories of Frank Lloyd Wright and his kind of, who was actually a very wealthy architect, but he would often live on this feast or famine cycle. And he believed that, you know, he was quite irresponsible with his money. And he kind of believed that he worked better and his creative energy and juices were far more, you know, fervent and powerful when he was kind of on the breadline. So he would do irresponsible things with the money that he had acquired. So there's this kind of sort of strange relationship that we have in the cult of design with money. And, you know, I've had it on the podcast where I've had great architects say that they're not sure about the business lens or the relationship between money and architecture. So some of the really old school architects we've had on the show will kind of point towards that, right? They'll kind of, and certainly the ones who have been in academia will discuss that as well. So we're kind of indoctrinated with it. I mean, a lot of spiritual traditions as well will talk about wealth, and there's lots of misinterpretations of great religious traditions and their attitude and approach to wealth. And will often, you know, you've got the archetypal character of somebody who's all powerful and very corrupt with their power and their money. Okay, so I think that's an archetypal human story that's been with us through civilizations and probably is not going to go anywhere. And it's kind of mixed up with all sorts of things. And there's an ease, you know, with us in terms of it's easy to become virtuous by incriminating the wealthy.
Mm-hmm. Indeed. Indeed. Right.
And then I think that becomes unhelpful to our own financial situations. And also it prevents us from seeing lots of opportunity.
Indeed. And it goes back to what you said in the manifesto, which is this idea of follow your passion, right? Mm. Is that, you know, we're going to sacrifice everything, our health, our wellness, the financial wellness of our team members, on the altar of my passion. Now, one of the other challenges as well, that this is a more systemic challenge, is that just by the very nature of the way that we're designed as architects, our brains and our preferences, they're diametrically opposed to, generally speaking, the attributes that would be ascribe to someone who would be financially inclined. Let me explain what I mean. Right? We know that within smart practice, some of the tools that we give firm owners are spreadsheets, are financial tracking software. Now, of course, what we recommend to them is that they have an accountant, a CFO, a controller, a bookkeeper, do all that for them so they don't have to. Right? But what we do know is that it's like pulling teeth as an architect to have to track the money. And if you're listening to this, you're probably shaking your head saying, yes, Enoch, it is. I hate it. And this is one thing that we hate about business, because naturally in the very part of our brain that loves to design, that loves the freedom of exploring, solving problems, that loves the lack of constraints, is the very same part of us that cringes at the idea of numbers, of spreadsheets, of having to worry about money. That's just cringeworthy, right? So it's also something just built into the artistic DNA of being a designer that naturally goes against that, right? The two are diametrically opposed. It's very rare that you find someone who has that artistic bent, who has that design bent, and they're also really financially savvy and they have a strong financial sense and they care about that, just because of the way the human brain works. So we can say that some of it is our fault. We need to take responsibility for it. Others, it's just the way we're wired. But at the end of the day, if we're not going to do it, we can hire someone else to do it, right? We can invest in ourselves. We're not victims. We're not the people that have to accept the cards that we were dealt. We have a choice in the matter. We have a say in the matter. And it's only going to be possible if we start to, first of all, step number one is to be aware, because in our four-part framework that I talk about a lot, it's like step number one of growth is number one, being asleep. This is the status quo. Number two is being aware. Number three is becoming activated. And number four is becoming awake. So step number one to turning the tide on the cult of Zion is, first of all, just recognizing it, just being aware of it, that it's there. So our invitation for you who's listening to this podcast is share this podcast, share this episode and these episodes on this conversation about the cult of design, because the more we can be aware of this, the more we can then start to be incentivized to make a shift so that ultimately we're not having to unionize. We're not having to go through another recession. We're not having to, you know, have the forces of nature against us to force us to change. We're actually changing of our own free will, of our own desire, our own belief, our own possibility of being able to build a new conversation in the architectural community.
Beautiful. There's other things that are kind of brewing and brimming here, and I want to kind of echo the sentiment of that we are the ones responsible. And this is not a question of we are to blame.
Right.
It's an empowering conversation to say that I have responsibility and I have the ability to be able to respond to the circumstances that the industry finds itself in, and we can unpick the kind of, you know, the darkness, or we can kind of find light in the darkness of the cult of design that's obscured things. We can train ourselves, we can learn about business, we can learn about marketing, we can learn about communications, we can learn about listening and understanding and developing and creating services that are perceived to be value in the marketplace. And for the students out there, I know so many young students, as you said, the younger generation, they have a lot more awake, if you like, because they're demanding more, because they also see more. You know, they have more opportunities. They don't need to be an architect. They could be a YouTuber.
Yeah.
You know, there's the kind of the internet and social media has opened up the possibility, if you like, and it's made people see a lot more opportunities in all sorts of different areas. So I hope the students as well start to demand more from their institutions, and I know that they are. I mean, in the UK here, we've got places like the London School of Architecture, which are very innovative, and they're, you know, they're producing students that the industry absolutely adores, and that, you know, students are starting to, you know, if you want to make money from architecture, then we want to be having a culture starting off early on as possible, which embraces money and finance and commercialism, and anything that doesn't, well, then that's a kind of architectural philosophy course or architectural design thinking program, which is also very valuable and has its place. And you might find that that kind of stuff is better rewarded somewhere else.
Wow. Well said. Well, we look forward to your feedback. If you want to send us feedback for this, you can write to support@businessofarchitecture.com. You can also head over to the website businessofarchitecture.com, and there's a contact form. You can send us any feedback or comment on there. Reach out to us on social media. That's where we're active. Ryan's very active on Instagram. I'm active on Instagram. Ryan, you can find Ryan on there at Ryan handle for Instagram.
My personal one is at Rion Willard, and then there's at Business of Arch UK as well.
Yep, and then for me, it would be, I think it's at Business of Arch. Yeah, it's just Business of Arch. And of course, at Enoch.Sears is my personal. Shoot us up, shoot a little message, follow us over there. And if you've been listening to the podcast for a while, go head over and leave us a review on iTunes. We want to know what you think. We want to continue to bring you good content. We want to know what you think about this episode of The Cult of Design. Have we got it wrong, or have we nailed something here that's a conversation that needs to happen?
Absolutely. We want to hear from you.
Indeed. Ryan, as always, carpe diem.
Bye
for now. And that's a wrap. This episode is sponsored by Smart Practice. the world's leading step-by-step business training program that's helped more than 103 architecture firm owners structure their existing practice so the complexity of business doesn't get in the way of their architecture. Because you see, it's not your architecture or design skills that's holding you back. It's the complexity of running a business, managing projects and people, dealing with clients, contractors, and money. So if you're ready to simplify the running of your practice, go to businessofarchitecture.com/smart to discover the proven, simple, and easy to implement smart practice method for running a practice that doesn't get in the way of doing exceptional architecture. The views expressed on the show by my guests do not represent those of the host, and I make no representation, promise, guarantee, pledge, warranty, contract, bond, or commitment except to help you conquer the world. Carpe Diem.